Good morning. I'm Keith. I'm a film director. I'm also probably the worst speaker. Earlier this last week, I was watching the Oscars, and I was so impressed how the presenters spoke with such confidence and how easy they were. They were doing the Oscar Award for cinematography, and Janusz Kaminski was up on the stage with two actor types. And they said, this is Janusz, who was famous for being Steven Spielberg's cameraman, and he had won an Oscar for Schindler's List. And they said how unusual it was, because this was the first time that they had had a technician up on stage, and the last. So I feel a bit like that. But what I'm going to be doing for you is I'm going to walk you through my work, my life in advertising, and how that relates to South African advertising, and that's over 30 years. So 30 years ago, in the middle 70s, we started having TV. We were kind of late starters. And by the end of the 1970s, TV had gone commercial. There were no such things as film schools or advertising schools. There was nowhere to learn your craft. If you had wanted to find out how to make films, or if you wanted to be... you either worked on like small Jamie Ace type productions, or you went to a broadcast house, and that's where I'd been working. So South African ads were just starting out, and we'd managed to sort of like entice a few out of work sort of English admin to come show us how to do it. Our first 5 years work was naive and mostly really bad, and everything seemed very retail orientated. So I pick up my story sort of in the middle 1980s. I was working as a cameraman at the time on commercials, and I suppose the work standards had started improving, budgets were getting a little bit better, and we had taken a few still photographers and developed them into quite good directors. Advertising in England at that stage was being revolutionized. I mean, the cigarette ads were kind of like the big rage of the day. There was an agency in London called CDP, and they were doing really outrageous work. There was also the Big Five, a bunch of directors that were sort of led by the Scott brothers, Tony and Ridley. And there was Adrian Lynn and Alan Parker, Hugh Hudson. And these guys, back at that stage, were shooting million-dollar commercials and just having... They were just turning the world upside down. And the most unusual, bizarre cigarette ads, fashion. And, even food products were being... Like Hover's Bread were getting these lavish, huge productions. It was, I suppose, what they called the start of the golden years. Life in South Africa was not as optimistic. Getting to see any kind of new trends or what was being created abroad, you had no chance of looking at anything. There were no showreels around, there's no work. There wasn't even an advertising mag here for us. Shots, DVDs or mags, they hadn't even started. Our only contact with the world of advertising was a yearly visit to Cannes. And then maybe 6 months later, you'd get a VHS copy of the ads, and you'd walk around with that as your piece of gold. Worse still, I suppose, was there was a world embargo. South Africa was being boycotted. We were being isolated. All the international corporates were leaving South Africa, and the few good creatives that we had, the few good directors, we're all being tempted and lured away by the big buck or the big dollar in America. What a bummer. Maybe. For me, how to turn a negative into a positive. It was time for me to step up to the plate, and I duly announced that I was going to be director. I knew nothing. There were no rules. But I was willing and wanting. It was 1987. Tristan.
The road is long.
No matter how long the road we travel, or how great the tasks ahead, one computer company is here with you every step of the way.
Introducing SP-33. Very tenacious, very sure-footed. Gripping in the wet and in the dry. SP-33. It grips.
You know, there are all kinds of people in the world. Some only care about a badge, while others don't seem to care what car they drive. Then there will always be those who appreciate a car which offers a unique combination of reliability, technical superiority, and driving excitement. Then there's the matter of personal safety, along with the support of the people who make and look after those cars. People with a special brand of commitment which has made them the number one motor manufacturer for more than 10 years. People who add that special touch, which makes owning your vehicle a truly rewarding experience. You know, all things considered, it's hardly surprising that most people grow up to be Toyota drivers.
Imagine it is the evening of October the 14th, 1988. Imagine you are Christopher White driving home. You're extremely tired and not watching the road properly. In some accidents, no car could save life. In others, only the safest car could. Christopher White survived this 100-meter plunge for two reasons. He was wearing his seatbelt, and he was driving a Mercedes-Benz.
ISM was about IBM leaving South Africa. We had needed a really well-trained African elephant. Funnily enough, a really difficult thing to do and to find. We found Jabu in America, and we brought her back. She then adopted a young calf that had been saved from a cull in the Kruger Park. This spot was always designed and intended to be shot during the magic light hours, beautiful sunset skies, long shadows, all sort of the rage of the day. I felt this was like really romantic for such a tough story. So we decided to shoot in the middle of the day in the harshest, worst, ugly light. It was kind of unheard of, and you could kind of feel the client balking, but we did it. And I think that sort of like real tough and like ugly light gave you the emotion of a really tough struggle. At that stage as well, like all the ads were based on being nice, feel-good, emotional kind of ads. And then Toyota was shot in the hill climbing Kruisdorp where I'd grown up. And I knew the kids, the local kids from the area, and I decided that they looked right and felt right for this period. I got them to come along, we cast them, they wore their own clothes, and for all of those kids, it was their first time in front of a camera. And this was also part of the feel-good South African factor. But Mercedes was the ad that started to kind of do something or make a dent or an inroad. It was a great ad to make. We had designed and built a cage for the camera to be inside the car so it would be protected when we threw the cars off the mountain. We had created a remote control driving system for the car so that we could steer it off the mountain. It had been a lot of prep work and we were kind of ready to throw these cars off. The first take was the best take. Everything had worked great, except that the camera had burst open inside the car. 4 days and 6 cars later, we'd got the shot. I never wanted to leave South Africa. I wanted the world to come here and to recognize our talent. But it wasn't easy. How to do it? I suppose Mercedes was a little way. It was our first big effort of getting noticed. It became South Africa and my first gold lion. I remember being in Cannes that year and being so incredibly surprised and proud when we learned that we had won gold, and then realizing that I didn't have anything appropriate to wear to the ceremony. Robin Putter, who was one of the judges, saved the day for me. He took me shopping, he bought me a new shirt. Coming back to South Africa, I walked through customs and I was waving my gold lion. I was so happy. There were no autographs, just a few blank stares. But our ads still didn't measure up to any kind of world standard, but we had started to make a little dent in the market. I'd also managed to sort of kickstart my directing career, and I was about to enter my car period.
Woo! away to the deerproof bus for the 200th time when suddenly...
Falskun!
So I race down the pass to Vostreis to call the fire chief and his truck, old Elias.
Hey, man, there's a fire on the deerproof bus, let's go!
We ring our bells and screech our cars with a Vostreis first in for a boss prize. We rescue cats and put our cars with the ladders and buckets and old Elias.
Falskun! It's at times like these that a man needs a pal.
With a false race, first team, put a boss prize. We rescue cats and put out fires in a new 2.55-cylinder Volksy bus. We zoom our fields at 100 miles with our ladders and buckets and only lies in a 2.55-cylinder Volksy bus.
Falskun! That's the story of the 2.55-cylinder Volksy bus.
Perhaps it was the coin cast into the well that did it. Or maybe the wish made on a star. Whatever it was, someone heard it and listened. In a faraway continent, in ancient cities and villages, from an emperor's palace to Jacques' café, they rose a little earlier this morning to prepare their world for you. That has witnessed the centuries come and go, the seasons change and romance bloom. It's not every day they get to see a wish come true. Europe, much more than you wished, for much less than you thought.
So things were changing, they were getting better. Clients started trusting us a little more. The work was coming a bit bolder, budgets were getting better. I'd shot two of these ads. I'd gone over and shot them in Europe, and I kind of felt like I was part of an international scene now. But I still know or knew I needed to make or be or have an international connection. The SAA Cost Cutters was a wonderful trip. We had rented a big bus and we went through Europe and traveled for 3 weeks. And I had all my friends as crew. We didn't... there wasn't a script. We didn't have a storyboard. If you saw something, we shot it. We made it up as you went along. And there was a young copywriter that was with us on the bus. Very much in awe and happy to be part of the gang. It was his first ever job. He came home and he penned some of the finest copy to hold the spot together. His name was Graham Warsop. It was the early 90s. There was a lot of resistance to South Africa abroad. But I had now acquired an international partner and I was about to enter my blue period.
Thank you.
318i. Now, with power steering. Surprising when you consider how he trains. The new 8-cylinder BMW 5 Series.
There was a new small startup agency, Huntless Scarers, and they had just got the BMW account. I'd got to do the Mercury job, which sort of sounded easy enough, but it wasn't to be. All the big international post-production companies were still very reluctant to want to work with South Africans, or maybe the job was too tough for them. Creating Mercury to look like a car traveling on a road and making that as a computer graphic proved to be incredibly challenging. We kind of couldn't really get the job done. So we decided to import a computer. We imported our own animation system. It was huge and bulky. It was really big and noisy, and it took up two office spaces. In fact, when we got the machine to come out here, we needed to get military clearance on it because it had the capacity to build a nuclear bomb. It was an awesome machine. We wrote and designed a program that would help us make the Mercury. The computer was in my office, and we went to work. It took us 18 months. We were 1 year over schedule. You don't go over schedule, never. Not 1 month, not 1 week, not even 1 day. We are over a year and deep in the shit. It was a new agency, a new account. Everybody was incredibly twitchy. We tried to beg forgiveness and maybe as compensation to the agency and client. We agreed to take a small print campaign I had and turn it into a TV ad. And so was born BMW Mouse. We then trained the mouse for 6 weeks. Until he was capable of running along the dashboard and jumping onto the steering wheel. We shot the ad in the studio, and it took us the morning. We had finished the shooting the ad before lunch. It took us 4 hours. We had no idea that it would become the legend it did. It was the most awarded car ad. It was described as the best car ad ever, and it was placed into Ads Hall of Fame. It won us 2 Golden Lions, and it launched everybody's career. Huntless Scarers got international acceptance and recognition, and it launched my career internationally. That was the start of our golden years.
turned low.
Who place their destiny with the finger of fate, not hands of expertise. To those who throw caution to the wind instead of weathering the storm. To those who slept with Lady Luck and bore sons of shame. To all those who search for the sure bet. Even when there wasn't one. Here's the bottom line. You either made money today, or you didn't.
I'm Ellen Donald.
I'm Hansen.
Last year, Sam found out that he had leukemia. At Reach for a Dream, we help children with life-threatening diseases to face their illnesses. Because children like Sam need courage and hope. And all the friends they can get.
There is an ancient legend of the man who invented chess. On learning of the game, his emperor offered him all the treasures he desired, but all he asked was for a single grain of rice, and that it should be doubled for every square on the chessboard. The emperor thought him foolish, but granted him his wish. As the grain of rice was doubled across every square, it became quite apparent that the emperor had misjudged the man's prudence. not enough rice in the entire kingdom to meet the man's request. To this day, there is a group of people who still live by this principle of compounding wealth. What did your money do today? Wouldn't it be great to have a milk bottle that could tell you when the milk had gone off? Impossible? Think about it. Let's take a bottle. Let's combine it with a home pregnancy test kit, which gives it the ability to change color. We now have a bottle that changes color according to the chemical makeup of its contents. Fill the bottle with milk, and the moment the milk goes sour, the bottle goes green. An intelligent bottle of milk. Why not? Cecil, reaching new frontiers.
So now it was the start of a new century. The work was good, life was good. South Africa was accepted into the international market. Clients were coming here and we were going there. Everything was just coming up roses, but I wasn't okay. I loved working on these ads, but they had become very challenging. When you're on a run, you stay on it. I think in this game, the commitment has got to be total. There are no half measures. The stress levels are big, and sometimes you pay the ultimate price. You either end up in a loony bin, a rehab center, divorced, or maybe all three. I needed a crack. A break. that part comes later. So like I was saying, I needed a break. I could see the cracks appearing, or maybe I could see the crack appearing. But, I hadn't had a break for nearly 20 years. I was exhausted. I took a year off. I needed to find myself, and I needed to spend some time with my family. Life needs a balance, probably the most important thing that we can try and do with our lives. But sometimes it's a lot easier said than done. The year flew by. It was the best thing that I could have done. But I still needed to prove something. I had unfinished business. I wanted to be the best. And I wanted to be the best that I could be, and I thought that I haven't given myself a proper chance. I desperately wanted to make that one big one. But coming back after a year away wasn't easy. There were new kids on the block, and everybody had their new favorite. I decided to shoot two spec ads that would relaunch me and my career.
Oh,
So these two ads had the impact that I was wanting. I was back up and running in no time. But I knew a few things now, and I knew I had to do them differently. I had to become more selective in my choice of work. I had to take on less ads, and I had to make them work harder. I needed to make ads that challenged me. I needed to be challenged by the ads. Most of all, I needed to please myself. Trends and styles were changing, and I needed a new look. I needed to be a chameleon. I needed to change the style of the music. I needed to do the editing differently. I needed to do everything differently. I needed to make myself contemporary. I needed to make a difference.
Until this day, sometimes I cry. He didn't even say goodbye. He didn't take the time to lie. Bang, bang, he shot me down. Bang, bang, I hit the ground. Bang, bang, that awful sound. Bang, bang, my baby shot me down.
That's 25 million. $40 million. $50 million. At $82 million. Last time at $82,500,000.
They would not listen, they did not know how. Perhaps they'll listen now.
A great man once said, "It's not answers that change the world. It's questions." Think about it. What if that crazy guy never said, "But can't we do better than a horse and cart?" Or if no one ever asked, "Why can't we harness energy?" What if Shakespeare's writings were not to be? If there was no such thing as childlike curiosity? What if Socrates never said, If Darwin didn't say, "You guys aren't gonna like this, but..." Maybe Einstein was right. Maybe we're only ever one question away from that next big step. So let's start with a little one. What if?
All I want to be is a shabbily bubbly gobbly goop.
Las noches no más se le iba y en borotora. Dice que no comía, no más se le iba y en borotoma. juran que el mismo cielo se estremecía al oír su llanto.
My papa taught me two important things. Always look for potential.
Hola, chicos.
Hola.
Then,
hola, ma.
Have the patience to wait for it.
Yeah, so I suppose if you ask me, do awards matter? Yeah, of course they do. It's amazing to be recognized by your peers. And, you know, I often get asked, do I have a favorite or do I have a best ad? And I always have the same answer. Yes, it's the one I'm working on now. Thank you.